Good evening, everyone.
Good evening. Good evening,
and welcome to Drake University. And welcome to the start of the fourth annual Nelson Institute Conference on Global Affairs. This conference highlights Drake's commitment to global citizenship and experiential learning and our mission promise to prepare our graduates to be responsible global citizens. A few of our more recent global pride points here at Drake University. We've been named a top producer of Peace Corps volunteers. Students in our class of 2016 found jobs in 20 different countries, and we are presently home to students from 42 different countries around the world. Now, throughout the conference, we'll be celebrating many things, and I just want to highlight a few of these. First, more than 30 Drake students who have become Fulbright scholars over the past several years will be on campus and be acknowledged. We will also, tomorrow evening, launch the Drake Community Press book, A Spectrum of Faith, Religions of the World in America's Heartland. You won't want to miss that event. And also, we'll be highlighting some research by our undergraduate students from both Drake and other institutions on international affairs. Now, this conference and many other things we do in terms of our global engagement would not be possible without the generous support of R.W. and Mary Nelson. The R.W. received his bachelor's degree in biology from Drake in 1950, and he and Mary founded Kimmett Industries in 1961. Their generosity created the Roland and Mary Nelson Institute for Diplomacy and International Affairs in 2012. And they continue to be deeply engaged in our efforts to make Drake into a more powerful, more impactful global institution. I also want to call out the fact that this week's events will include the Drake Halal chapter sponsoring a talk by Holocaust survivor Magda Brown on Friday night at 7 p.m. here in the Sussman Theater. And Ms. Brown's talk will serve as a nice compliment to tonight's speaker, who himself serves as a fellow with the U.S. Holocaust Memorial Museum. It is now my pleasure to introduce Ambassador Stephen Rapp. Ambassador Rapp is a Drake Law alumnus and served as U.S. Ambassador at Large for Global Criminal Justice from 2009 to 2015. In that role, he was credited with arranging for the United Nations Commission of Inquiry and other prosecutorial authorities to gain access to a cache of 55,000 photos documenting torture by the Assad regime in Syria. From 2007 to 2009, Ambassador Rapp served as prosecutor for the Special Court for Sierra Leone. His office achieved the first convictions in history on crimes against humanity charges for sexual slavery and forced marriage, and for attacks on peacekeepers and the recruitment and use of child soldiers as violations of international humanitarian law. From 2001 to 2007, he served as senior trial attorney and chief prosecutor at the International Criminal Tribunal for Rwanda, where he led the trial team that achieved the first convictions in history against leaders of the mass media for the crime of direct and public incitement to commit genocide. We are very pleased and proud to have Ambassador Rapp with us this evening. Please join me in welcoming him to the podium.
Thank you very much, President Martin. It's great to be here at Drake at this at the beginning of this Nelson Institute conference. Also, as I understand it, a sort of a global connectivity event, and then I'm staying on through Saturday for the Constitutional Law Center annual symposium. So it's 4 days in Des Moines at Drake University, and all the great things that are happening here certainly make me very proud to be a Drake alum. And to be here with all of you, my fellow Iowans, all of you, except my wife who grew up in Missouri, though she's been an Iowan for 40 years now. But it's great to be back and to be talking with you about this subject, which I've spent a lot of energy on for now the last 16 years since I left my job as United States Attorney in Cedar Rapids in Sioux City, Iowa, and moved my family in May of 2001 to Arusha, Tanzania, in East Africa, to become a senior trial attorney at the International Criminal Tribunal for Rwanda, the court that was established by the United Nations to try those responsible for the genocide, for the murder of 800,000 men, women, and children in a period of 100 days. And at dinner this evening, people were asking me, as they always did, how and why did one move from Cedar Rapids, Iowa, to Africa, and why from prosecution and legal work here in the state of Iowa, and engagement in public policy issues to the international arena. And it's very related to this topic, which is bringing war crimes perpetrators to justice. Certainly related a lot to my experience as a federal prosecutor in the state of Iowa for 8 years, because these are fundamentally the same things. People who commit predatory acts against their fellow human beings for whatever selfish end, in the interest of the exercise of their own power, or in the interest of gaining wealth, for reasons that motivate them to exercise their power in cruel and brutal ways. And the lessons that we learn and the ways that we approach that in our own system, I think, inform us when we go to the international level almost as much as dealing with the very important and the very challenging questions of the substantive and procedural issues that you have to face there. All of us who've been in law practice, all of us that are in life, periodically have to adapt the lessons that we learn in one place and find that the sort of key ones really do carry over. I remember when I was U.S. attorney, which I was for about 8 years, U.S. attorneys would periodically be called to Washington to other national conferences, and became close friends with U.S. attorneys across the country, people like Loretta Lynch, who was recently the attorney general, was a great colleague, and these people would say, you know, what do you do out in Iowa? You know, we've got crime in Brooklyn, or we've got crime in Miami. You know, we've got crime in Chicago, for heaven's sakes. Do you have any crime out there? And I said, oh, there's plenty to keep us busy. But and indeed, I very much enjoyed the role of United States attorney, because a small office, and it involved constantly a matter of building partnerships. And certainly when I talk about the international level and how you prosecute people, and particularly now in our very challenged world, it's always a question of partnerships. Here it was, you know, the federal working with the state, working with the local, but always with the community, because that's who you're protecting, and that's whose cooperation, the victims, the survivors, the people impacted by these crimes. Those are the people you're doing it for in the end. You're not doing it for the state. You're not doing it for some abstract government entity. You're doing it to really prevent criminal organizations from gaining a foothold. And what would happen if there weren't such offices, if we didn't have law enforcement? Now, we might think utopian thoughts that everyone would be happy and get along, but we all in our undergraduate survey courses read Hobbes' Leviathan, and certainly my experience in places where there's a breakdown of the law is that life indeed becomes nasty, brutish, and short. Now, to prevent that, we don't need authoritarian governments, or we don't need a Leviathan, but we need what we call the rule of law. And in a democracy, that's a situation where the agents of the state work for the people, where they all work for us. And a free society, it involves people broadly being able to do what they want unless they harm others. But the law works, and indeed people analyze these questions and debate them for certain reasons. Obviously there's the question of deterrence, and certainly I saw it as a U.S. attorney. If I decided that I was going to go after use a particular statute to go after crime, certainly when it came to white-collar crime, people changed their conduct and tried to comply with the law and avoid difficulties. And I think there is something called general deterrence. It's always hard to prove, but there's also the establishment of norms that make these sorts of rules that we adopt generally by relatively broad consensus, a sort of second nature. And people don't brush up against the law because they obey it in the first place. And as some have recently shown, even at the international level, and I can talk, I'll get to the international level to a greater extent in a moment, but people always say, oh, you're not having any kind of impact at all. There are some friends of mine, Catherine Sinkin, who used to be in Minnesota, she's now at Harvard, and Beth Simmons, that have actually done work showing that countries that have had prosecutions of serious human rights violations have a much lower level of violence and impunity for other crimes thereafter. These things, even though they may not be as broad as we like them to be, can really have an effect. But the thing that you certainly learn when you go to the international level is that this whole process of justice is fragile. Make it even, and it's broken down in places. In countries that have very good constitutions and seem to be protecting rights in the same way that we are, where if there's not professionalism in law enforcement, if people aren't paid properly, if there's not a real effort to ferret out those that are dishonest, if one shorts the courts the whole process, if one intimidates people that sit as judges and says they're just dancing to political tunes, you can undermine our system of justice and bring the law into contempt. One of the countries I recall visiting when I was ambassador at large was the Philippines. I went there in 2011. I actually encouraged them to ratify the ICC. They said, oh, the U.S. doesn't want us to ratify. I said, no, we're now engaging with the International Criminal Court. We'd like to have friendly countries in there. And I gave several public speeches and engaged with Parliament and said this was a good thing. I remember one of the people that I worked with very close was then the Minister of Justice, Lila de Lima, who had been, and I was also engaging with them to help us at that time on Burma, where we were trying to get a commission of inquiry. This is before Aung San Suu Kyi was freed. And of the human rights abuses there. And the Philippines was a real leader. This is a country that has a constitution that reads just like ours. They were our colony for 40 years. Filipino Americans are the backbone of our military and a great community in the United States. But just in the last few months, we have a president who was elected, who's very popular. And he boasts about, you know, killing drug dealers, drug users. 7,000 people have been murdered in cold blood in the Philippines in the past few months. Former Minister of Justice de Lima, my friend who was elected to the Senate, she chaired an investigative commission on the crimes, brought in evidence about crimes that he committed in Davao, and because he had a political majority, she was removed from the Senate, and she's now in prison, or in detention, on bogus drug charges. So one sees that you know, one has to constantly protect these institutions. And of course, one of the ways that we hope to be able to affect these kinds of situations across the world is through international law, through human rights law, but the law that I'm particularly interested in is international criminal law, which comes to us from several sources, a large part of it from an area of law that we call humanitarian law, from the Geneva Conventions, from the Hague Conventions. We do have norms. We do have rules. And to some extent, some of these rules were first codified in the United States during the Civil War by Professor Lieber, and the Lieber Code that Lincoln promulgated in 1863. And that became part of the Hague Convention of 1899, but rules about not attacking hospitals and rules about civilian or non-combatant immunity. Obviously, in conflict, there are going to be bad things that happen, but one doesn't intentionally target civilians, one doesn't use disproportionate force to attack military targets that will have an impact on civilians unless there's a clear military necessity. I mean, there are rules that are there, but frankly, other than at a relatively low level, had never been enforced. We have other rules that have been established by conventions. The Torture Convention, which was ratified in 1984, never, no how, nowhere can there be a torture or cruel treatment, not for any justification whatsoever. And a crime of such important significance that it was basically made one of absolute universal jurisdiction, like piracy. And every state in the world was empowered to prosecute torture anywhere, by any country, in any country, whether the perpetrator or victim was present. Now, whether the country wants to do that, or they're the wise ones to do it, is another question. But there are those rules. And there were the rules that that came to us from Nuremberg, which I'll talk about in a little bit, that involve crimes against humanity, widespread and systematic attacks against civilian populations, and as part of those attacks, murder, rape, cruel treatment, imprisonment, displacement, sexual slavery, other violent acts, and acts that can occur even not in a conflict, such as we've often had after contested elections in some developing countries where thousands of people are killed by militias supporting one party or another in order to intimidate those communities. And we have the Genocide Convention, which grew out of World War II when the Holocaust was committed. 6 million Jews murdered in cold blood, gypsies and others, these groups fundamentally destroyed or destroyed in substantial part and with intention to destroy those groups in whole if they've been able to get away with it. So we have these rules, and the question is, you know, who, how do you enforce them? And we got really the first effective answer to that at Nuremberg. And in something that I think is one of the, you know, greatest things that happened in the last millennium, these rules were applied, not as international law, treaty-based law had often been applied in the past against states. We're going to punish this state, make it pay reparations, we're going to punish all the people in this country because they have a bunch of bad leaders, we're going to make them pay, but against the individual perpetrators. Individual criminal responsibility was the key to it. And the other aspect of it, because to the extent there had been prosecutions for war crimes, they'd been relatively low-level people, the idea is that this should be the most senior man, those that really had made it happen. Justice Jackson is a hero of mine. If you know the story of Justice Jackson, initially came from a small town New York practice, supported Franklin Roosevelt for president, came to Washington to head the tax division, then to be Solicitor General, then to be Attorney General, and in 1941 to be appointed to the United States Supreme Court. In 1945, President Truman asked him to take a year without leaving the Supreme Court to go to Nuremberg. Well, first to go to London to negotiate the statute, and then to go to Nuremberg to prosecute, to lead the American side of what was a four-nation prosecution. And if you ever want to see great speeches in court, read his opening speech in November 21st, 1945, and his closing speech in July 1946. I think probably the greatest speeches ever given in a courtroom. But my favorite line of really the first few minutes of the speech, and there's just wonderful quotable ones in there, is the one in which he says that the common sense of man requires that the law should not stop with the punishment of petty crimes by little people. It must reach men who possess themselves of great power and make deliberate and concerted use of that power to set in motion evils which touch every home. And so Nuremberg, in that first great trial of the International Military Tribunal, was about prosecuting people that were at the pinnacle of power in Nazi Germany. Hermann Göring, who was essentially, until the very end, essentially the number two to Hitler, others, Ribbentrop, the foreign minister, people that represented different parts of the Nazi regime, the propagandists, Streicher, the head of the SD that ran the concentration camps, Kaltenbrunner. 18 of them, of the 21 that were charged and that stood trial in person, were convicted. Three was acquitted, were acquitted. There followed and that trial was the one that's called International Military Tribunal. There followed 12 subsequent trials, also done at Nuremberg, under the order of the occupation government in Berlin, but of people that had been arrested, and almost everyone who was arrested wanted to turn themselves over to Americans, and certainly not to the Russians. But we prosecuted 12 subsequent trials, including the doctors and the industrialists and the government ministers. And the most famous one, from my point of view, and it's all about our responsibilities as judges and lawyers, was the judges' trial, the one that is dramatized in the great Oscar-winning movie Judgment at Nuremberg, starring Spencer Tracy as the state court judge that tries that case, and Burt Lancaster as the German judge that eventually Tracy convicts and sentences to life. But these trials, in fact, filled in this whole system of international criminal law to a substantial extent. And when we were trying, when I was trying the Charles Taylor case in the special court for Sierra Leone, we were constantly going back to the case laws of the subsequent proceedings at Nuremberg. But they all ended, I think I was 3 months old when the last Nuremberg case adjourned in April of 1949. And then we had basically a 45-year break in which there was really no progress on this at all. And it was only after the end of the Cold War, and that's not to say horrible things didn't happen in the Cold War, some of which we tried to go back and deal with, the Guerra Sucia, horrible crimes committed by military governments and sometimes by leftist groups in Latin America, the horrors of the Khmer Rouge and in Cambodia, killing 2 million out of 8 million, killing almost 2 million out of a population of 8 million, a quarter of the population. But it wasn't possible at a time when the international institutions were blocked by a Russian veto in the Security Council. We weren't able to do anything. And then after the fall of the Berlin Wall, and after we did have atrocities, some of them not unrelated to the loss of some of the kind of state controls that had occurred beforehand, the echoes of Nuremberg were heard. In fact, Madeleine Albright used that expression in the Security Council in May of 93, when something it's something that's now been there. And we've used this for a long time, but it was extremely innovative, the idea of a Security Council, establishing a court. You read the UN Charter, you say, well, there's an International Court of Justice, that's where countries can sue each other. But criminal courts, how can that happen? On the other hand, if you read the UN Charter, as people are just talking about their family members going while the UN up at UNI in the next few days, thinking about that. But if you read the UN Charter, there's the section on the Security Council, so-called Chapter 7. And it says that when the Security Council acts in the interest of peace and security in order to restore peace and security, its decisions are mandatory on all the world. It can deploy armed forces, it can do almost anything. It is the one example of world government, or it's often not used because you can't get the kind of unanimity that's required. Security Council, as I think everyone knows, 5 permanent members, ourselves, the Russians, Chinese, French, and Brits are always on it. 10 other countries rotate, 5 new ones elected every year from the General Assembly, and it takes 9 votes to win. And none of the permanent members can vote no. That is a veto. And so, but it in when the horrible crimes began to happen in the former Yugoslavia, when tens of thousands of Bosnians and Croats and others were suffering from attacks by Bosnian Serb forces that were trying to create a ethnically pure Greater Serbia, and doing it through not by shooting enemy soldiers, but by killing, raping, destroying villages, trying to drive people out, not more than forcible transfer, ethnic cleansing, really a crime against humanity, violence used in order to kill a few hundred, so it's a few thousand. But those crimes were committed by mid-decade. We had 100,000 dead. Friends from Kosovo who were here earlier, obviously the horrible crimes that happened there in 99 when ethnic cleansing was unleashed on what had been the province of Kosovo in Serbia, and when tens, really hundreds of thousands to escape certain death managed their ways toward the borders of Albania and Macedonia. But horrendous crimes, and of course people looking at that would say, what should we do? Can we send in peacekeepers with a robust mandate to protect people? They might be shot. And do we really want to get involved in this conflict? Do we want to get in the crossfire? And so rather than send in the soldiers, rather than send in even a robust police, the decision was, let's send in the lawyers and judges, and maybe they'll do some good. But we will do this by establishing a statute which applies these laws that are out there. Indeed, the treaties, the Geneva Convention, ratified by every country in the world. Genocide ratified by 140 or more, but is recognized as essentially part of what we call customary international law, which is kind of an international common law that develops out of legal developments across the world. And the crimes against humanity, if we're talking about it, come to us from Nuremberg and we're part of law. So we'll establish a court, give it the power to enforce these laws, or appoint a prosecutor. And we'll see what happens. And many people at the time were a little cynical, saying, send in the lawyers, and who's going to help them? And it did, and we can talk about it why, eventually far exceed expectations. That happened in 93. The following year, we had the genocide in Rwanda that I described earlier, 800,000 killed in 100 days. And how could the world stand aside when eight times as many were being killed in Rwanda? So a similar court was established. And in the years that followed, there were other courts established, not by the Security Council, but with the UN as a party, with countries such as the Special Court for Sierra Leone, where I went to prosecute after I was at the Rwanda Tribunal and the Cambodia Extraordinary Chambers. And we had, by many countries, the feeling that rather than having a separate court every time, let's have an international permanent court, the International Criminal Court. And as I think everyone knows, the United States decided not to join the ICC, though it now has 124 countries and has, under its statute, the ability to take cases that are referred to it by the UN Security Council. So what were these courts able to get done? More than one would expect. In the Rwanda Tribunal, we convicted the Prime Minister for the crime of genocide, Kambanda. In the Yugoslavia Tribunal, hard to believe when it began, in May of 99, during a Kosovo intervention, Prosecutor Arbor decided, and people were quite surprised, some unhappy, that she had decided to indict Milosevic, the President of Serbia. It was at that time we were engaged in a military operation. We hoped he would say uncle and withdraw. People said, if you're going to do this, he'll never quit. Within a month, he withdrew from Kosovo. Within a year, he couldn't steal enough votes to stay in power. And 25 months after he was indicted, and I was there in the head the day that it happened, he was in a helicopter arriving at the detention facility. In the Special Court for Sierra Leone, in a case that I personally was involved in, Charles Taylor, the president of Liberia, accused of having essentially been the godfather of the RUF, the Revolutionary United Front, and their allies, and the Armed Forces Revolutionary Council that became famous, if you've seen the movie Black Diamond, with chopping off hands and arms, cynically asking, short sleeves, long sleeves, the people who cruelly tortured and mutilated in that way. that was thousands, but there were tens of thousands killed in Sierra Leone, and certainly hundreds of thousands of women raped and sexually enslaved and turned into bushwives. And we were successful bringing him to trial and convicting him and sentencing him to 50 years in prison for 11 counts of war crimes and crimes against humanity. In the Yugoslavia tribunal, it took a while. Karadzic, who had been the leader of Republika Srpska, the Bosnian Serb state, as it called itself, that was engaged in this campaign of ethnic cleansing, was on the run for 13 years, was arrested finally in 2008. He's now been convicted of genocide, for the genocide of Srebrenica, and for war crimes and crimes against humanity across Bosnia and Croatia. And his general, who took 16 years to arrest, Mladic, Ratko Mladic, who was there in Srebrenica when 8,000 men and boys were killed, and were waiting for the judgment, but certainly evidence would indicate he's the one that ordered it. His trial is now concluded. We'll have a judgment before the end of the year. And the ICC, that in many ways, I would say, hasn't been as effective as the ad hoc tribunals, has President Bagbo of Cote d'Ivoire on trial together with his minister for youth and sport that were alleged to have been involved in the post-election violence and targeting foreigners and immigrants that occurred in Cote d'Ivoire in 2011 and 2012. So these courts have, in many ways, exceeded expectations. But as one looks at them, you say, well, Kambanda, that's Rwanda, Milosevic and Karadzic, that's the Yugoslavia tribunal. The ICC has jurisdiction because Cote d'Ivoire asked the court to come there. The Taylor case was in a special court for Sierra Leone. The government of Sierra Leone had asked the UN to help establish. And so obviously these international courts are limited. They can't go everywhere. And some people would say, well, if you can't go everywhere, you should go nowhere. It's not just to prosecute some and not all. That's not my own attitude. That's like somebody saying, well, I only killed 5 people. There's somebody else that you don't have to kill 15. You know, lay off me until you get the other person. Then you build the cases that you can build. But it is a problem. But at the same time, it's amazing to me what this has wrought. I mean, I don't think that the powers that authorized the creation of these courts quite knew what they were creating, and the kind of institutions that could come online to fulfill what I think are powerful expectations globally. I heard it was Ambassador at Large in the Obama administration after I finished my assignment in Sierra Leone, and I was in the position in Washington, I could say in Washington, in a nice office on the 7th floor and a small staff down the hall from Secretary Clinton and then Secretary Kerry as the U.S. Special Envoy on these issues, which involve one, working on our policy, whether the U.S. is going to support this or not support it, sort of getting the various parts of the U.S. government online through the Interagency and National Security Council process, even my colleagues in the State Department in a supportive position. But it fundamentally involved working with other countries. And it also involved dealing with situations where there isn't justice, not yet. And so I did spend a lot of time traveling. I joke about being at large. People say, what does it mean to be at large? I say, well, it's like being a fugitive. You're just always on the run, you know, because of the law. But I took it seriously, and I certainly I'm close to my friend George Clooney and the number of miles that I think that I've earned, though I tend to spend them as quickly as I earn them. But I did, during the course of my 6 years, travel almost 1.6 million miles into 87 countries, not to the Riviera that often anyway, but 15 times to the Democratic Republic of Congo, and every conflict zone. From those where the crimes happened 40 years ago, or even 70 years ago, because I was dealing with some Nazi cases and some Nazis
in the Baltic countries, but places where conflicts were ongoing, and where horrible crimes were being committed, and everywhere I went, it was like going around the world every 5 weeks in terms of the number of 1,250 days of travel. You know, I'd meet first with the victims, survivors, civil society, government, judges, ministers, other governments, UN, etc., and work on what could be done, should be done, always believing, as we do in the United States, that before you go to the international level, try the national one. And indeed, it's a principle of the ICC called complementarity. That court's only complementary. It fulfills what the national systems can't do, except in most of these conflict zones, where a court was already destroyed before the conflict even started, and under-resourced and everything else, and even in worse shape afterwards. Getting justice done at the national level isn't easy. But that said, the one thing that you discover is that everywhere you go, people say, you know, why haven't we had justice? What about the crimes that were committed against my mother, my sister, my brother? What about these people who remain in power and continue to exact and intimidate and humiliate us, as if it wasn't enough they did it to our families? What can you do to bring justice here? And it's not always easy, but there are things that are happening, and it requires, again, that development of what I talked about in Iowa, of partnerships, of working with the victims, working with human rights groups and others that can help marshal really strong evidence. And I'm an absolute fiend when it comes to strong evidence. I've seen what happens in courts when they don't have the evidence. And raise expectations of victims, and even put them at risk, and then you lose your case. And lose your case indeed. Maybe you should, and I believe in fair trials foremost, but one should not go to court unless you got enough to prove it. I used to say you needed about twice what you thought was reasonable before you really sort of put the system and even an alleged perpetrator through that process. So it is essential that be done, but there are situations where things are happening that that would surprise you. I mean, I'll just use a few examples. Recently, we had I'll be in Dakar, Senegal. Is what day's today? Today's the 5th of April. I'll be there in 3 weeks for the announcement of the final appeals judgment in the case of Hissam Habre, not well known in America. Was the dictator of Chad from 1984 to 1990. The United States, by the way, and France supported him in that role because he was fighting a proxy of Muammar Gaddafi from Libya. But he was a dreadful president and paranoid, crazy, and arrested people by the hundred, tortured probably, according to his own, the Truth and Reconciliation Commission in the country after he left power, killed 40,000 of his own people. Those that survive that experience don't forget it. And they have, one of the first visitors I had in my office in October of 2009 was Suleiman Gangang, who was a torture survivor from Chad. And they've been trying to find a court to present their evidence. One of the things that they had was absolutely incredible, and it was gathered by a friend of mine, Human Rights Watch, from some of the materials that the Truth and Reconciliation Commission had that hadn't published, but they found in the swimming pool, as they call it, the scene, that had been Habre's torture chamber, the records of the reports to Habre of the tortures and deaths with Habre's own hand on it. Don't let this person leave the prison alive. So it's fantastic evidence. And looking for form, Habre, by the way, when he was overthrown in 1990, had gone off to Senegal and written himself a check for the entire content of the Chadian treasury, and living high and sort of buying himself protection in Senegal. And they were trying to get a case going there, weren't having success. They'd gone to Belgium, which had universal jurisdiction, and Belgium was being discouraged from taking these cases. They were too far afield from Belgium, said, boy, this is the best one we've ever seen. And they started pursuing it and actually took Senegal to the World Court and sued Senegal and said, if you're not a prosecutor, we'll do it. You know, sort of prosecutor or extradite. But meanwhile, we worked hard with the government of Senegal and with the African Union to say this is a case that Africa can succeed at. And I was in a donors conference in Senegal on behalf of the United States in 2010. We had challenges with the government at that time, but eventually it was possible to organize a court in Senegal, a hybrid court under agreement with the African Union, and the African Union was really good at this. Civil law court, not a common law court like us, but with an investigation by examining magistrates. And I was there for the opening of the trial on July 20th, 2015. Habre has been convicted of mass crimes, of crimes against humanity, and war crimes, including rape. There were rape survivors, people that he, among the detainees that he personally raped. The case is now coming for a final appeal. Before this is called so-called, I'm thinking of the term in French, but it's Extraordinary African Chambers in English on the 27th of April. And we've done it all for $10 million, of which the U.S. contributed $1 million. So it's an example of how you can establish justice where otherwise not possible. One of the other cases that I dealt with, and this hasn't ended perfectly, though in many respects it's an incredible story, the case of the Chief of State of Guatemala, General Ephraim Rios Montt, who was supported by Reagan, called a hero in 1982, but according to the evidence, engaged in mass killing of the Maya people, the Exil group specifically, perhaps in the motivation claiming that they were the sea in which the rebels were swimming. The idea of bringing him to justice eventually came through a Spanish court, but in the meantime, the United States had been deeply involved with Guatemala, had developed, had supported an international commission on impunity in Guatemala, had reinforced their legal system, had created high-risk courts where judges would be protected in order to prosecute drug traffickers, corruption people, not necessarily human rights people, because it only had a jurisdiction from 96 forward. But that has provided the means in Guatemala to do these cases, and the brave Attorney General, Claudio Paz y Paz, pursued Rios Montt. I was there when he was convicted of the crime genocide in April of 2013. Later set aside on a technicality. He needs to be retried. His health is not good, whether he's retried or not. But if you talk to the victims, if you could see the courtroom on the day that he was convicted, there's a great movie out of it. I'm a law teacher. I'd be showing people documentaries all the time, but there's a new one called 500 Years, which is the third movie by a filmmaker named Pamela Yates, which describes the Rios Montt case, and then describes recently what CSIC helped create, which included the overthrow of the president and vice president who'd been convicted and been charged with the current vice president and president, I mean current as in 2015 and 16, for corruption. And one of the Rios Montt judges is actually the guy who, on the night that he resigns, President Perez Molina appears before Judge Pastrana, and Pastrana says, "You're a flagrant, Mr. President. I already detained you." So it's quite a scene in terms of what's possible when you really do reinforce the people in countries and use and have the strong evidence. The we've been able to do third country cases even in the United States. Charles Taylor Jr., the son of the guy I prosecuted, he'd gone and become head of his father's anti-terrorism unit and just loved torturing people to death. He was prosecuted in Miami, first person under the U.S. Torture Convention. U.S. torture law that we passed under the Torture Convention, and all crimes committed in Liberia, all Liberian citizens who were victims. He was sentenced by the U.S. District Court in Miami to 97 years, the decision affirmed by the 11th Circuit. All over Europe, we now have, and in our own country, war crimes units to prosecute people who are perpetrators of these crimes, who come in saying they're victims, but they're victimizers, and so developing those cases is possible. Well, against this, and against the structure that we're building, we have places where it isn't yet working, and the key one of which I've put an enormous energy in is Syria, because obviously Syria is a place where crimes are happening that belie everything that we're talking about. Norms that, crimes that weren't committed in World War II, didn't bomb hospitals intentionally, nobody did kill doctors on purpose in World War II. We didn't use poison gas in World War II. And yesterday, I was just talking to a doctor last night, communicating with an interpreter who was talking to a doctor in the town of Khan, Shikan, where more than 100 children and women, almost all children and women, were murdered, and almost certainly sarin gas, pinprick pupils, as he described, and foaming at the mouth, convulsions as people die, convulsions as people try to survive, and all of the other crimes. I've heard about my own work on the Caesar case. Caesar's become a good friend of mine. We hosted him in our home in Washington in July of 2014. A very brave man. Former Syrian military police guy who brings out 55,000 photos of people tortured to death in prison. Why does he have them? Because he led a group at the military police hospital where he had to photograph all these victims as the bodies came in by the hundred and create phony reports that could be thrown away, but at least would allow them to destroy them. Well, thrown away, but thrown into a file in which they'd be ignored, but that was his job. He brought that material out. Happy to bring him back to Washington 2 weeks ago and have him meet the congressional leadership to try to continue to do something on this. And it's based on those victims that we located a victim in Spain, a sister who's a citizen of a third country, who under their law, because she's a victim of the forced disappearance, had the ability to begin a criminal case against the senior leadership in Syria. On the 27th of March, 8 days ago, when the Spanish judge announced that the case was allowed, they had jurisdiction and they began to receive evidence on the 9th of April. Their case is being pursued in Germany and France as well. Something that's encouraging that's out there, you'd say, why isn't the ICC there? People say, how can the ICC deal with cases in Cote d'Ivoire with 3,000 dead when there are 450,000 dead in Syria, when at least 11 million of the 22 million who live in that country have fled their homes, with dramatic impact across our planet. Anyone that says these are just internal affairs just only has to look at Syria to realize what the external effects are, in fact, on the politics even of our own country. And so you have 11 million, I think, is a conservative estimate like that, but it's closer to 13. What can we do? We've tried to take it to the ICC, 13 votes for it, to take it to the ICC and the UN Security Council in June 2014. The United States voted for it. We encouraged all our friends to vote for it. Two countries, Russia and China, voted no. Those are vetoes, so this hasn't happened. But at the end of December, the General Assembly, by a vote of 105 to 15, established something new, a mechanism that will gather this evidence. And there are a number of documentation centers that we've helped establish, one of which has 750,000 pages of regime documents. Gather that together, verify it, deal with the digital material, everything else, the analysis that's been done by the OPCW on the chemical weapons, and build cases for countries that have jurisdiction. So yesterday the UN Budget Committee approved its budget and it's preparing to stand up. Not easy, but possible. And so even in a challenging time, when of course there's a lot of pushback on justice and even our own US commitment, whether even my office that I headed for 6 years and that others have headed, whether it'll be there. The momentum is there globally. But as in every case, in order to bring numerous perpetrators to justice, it takes building partnerships with the affected people themselves, providing the skills, the ability to gather and analyze the evidence, finding ways legally into court, to establish courts if you can, to find courts with jurisdiction if you can. But all of which gives me hope that this body of law, which at least offers some of the same protections that we have in societies that respect the rule of law, against making our lives nasty, brutish, and short, that we can succeed, and that we can indeed bring to justice those who commit the worst crimes known to humankind. So, thank you very much. So we said we'd have time for questions, 20 or 25 minutes. So fire away. Yes.
Excuse me. I have a question at a general level and then a specific level. Could you talk a little bit about how things get started with someone? Oh, gee, I think there's a crime against humanity over here. I'm going to go tell somebody, and we're going to do what you do to set up to have crimes against humanity investigated and ultimately prosecuted, how that process kind of works. And I'm also curious about how is it that the U.S. creating a war based on lies of this weapons of mass destruction, which there never were, and it's been proven repeatedly, and then to openly brag about torturing prisoners in Guantanamo and at our covert base in the Middle East, they're not nearly at the level of what Assad's doing, but do those even rise to the level of needing or deserving prosecution review, or are they just, no, that's covered by something else?
Well, those are very, very good questions, I'll try to be as brief as possible, but there are many layers to dealing with it. But understand, I mean, we know what crimes against humanity look like. We hear about these crimes from Human Rights Watch. We hear about them from local civil society organizations. We do have some mechanisms to at least investigate and report on them. If the Security Council has blocked the Human Rights Council in Geneva, which we're a member of, hopefully we won't leave under some pressure during the administration to actually leave the Human Rights Council. It's a body of 47 countries that are elected by the General Assembly of the UN, and the U.S. served for 6 years. The U.S. took off for a year and then was elected again in September, and Russia was actually beaten in the General Assembly for that. Anyway, we in that Human Rights Council, we have established commissions of inquiry for Syria, for a fact-finding mission for Iraq, for Sri Lanka, for Eritrea, for North Korea, famously, and that brought in very good reports describing what's going on, saying these are violations of human rights, but they also look to be violations of international criminal law. We've got a conflict going on, and civilians are being targeted, or people are being tortured, or there's a widespread systematic attack in a country, even like, say, Eritrea, that's not in war. Civilians or others are being brutalized. That's what's happening in Korea, for instance. And so those violations are found. And then people who are outside those countries are saying, where can we find justice? Some of those perpetrators are actually turning up. I mean, when I was in the Rwanda Tribunal, my wife Dolly went back there and worked after I went off to Sierra Leone. We had a dozen countries coming down saying, we've got some Rwanda genocidaires, we think, can you have some information on this guy, et cetera. But there are countries that want to have information. They may want to just only to decide we're not going to let this person be a refugee, because if you're a war criminal, you can't be a refugee under the conventions. So those things happen, and then you have in countries where victims can start criminal cases, in other words, in continental law systems, we communicate with police, and maybe your case is prosecuted, maybe it's not, but in those countries, victims can start. They pursue those things, but they're using in all of that these laws that are in a great many countries are actually part of the criminal code. We don't have crimes against humanity in our law, but we do have genocide, we do have war crimes in our law, in our statute book in Title 18. And there's pressure to have crimes against humanity, too. But if it's not crimes against humanity, you may be able to charge it as multiple murders, et cetera, than it'd be otherwise. So those are some of the ways that these things arise. But obviously, you know, one only has to read the papers and you can see the situations where these things have begun to occur. On the question of U.S. Conduct, let me just separate for a moment the weapons of mass destruction issue and what kind of crime we would be talking about. First of all, in terms of Iraq, and is there a court? Iraq hasn't established a court to try anybody for this in their own country, and there is no court that's been established to try the crime of aggression. We did that at Nuremberg, but we haven't done that at the ICC, though the ICC may this year finally approve including the crime of aggression under certain narrow circumstances, but only for post-2017 crime. So there's really no court to bring that in on. That's not to say Britain, which is in the ICC, has, there are a number of cases of it having mistreated civilians in Basra, in the part of Iraq that they occupied and were engaged in at the time that we went in together as the major parts of the so-called coalition of the willing. And so the Brits can be prosecuted in the ICC if you're in the country, if you're a state party and you commit a crime in anywhere in the world, your citizens can be prosecuted. So the ICC has begun a preliminary examination. That's caused the Brits to do a multi-million-dollar service prosecution investigation in which they're investigating these cases and determining if any of them are prosecutable. The ICC only has jurisdiction if they show that they don't have the will or capacity to do a genuine case. On the other hand, if they say we don't have the proof, no witnesses are coming forth, we can't do it, we've done our best, we're not charging, that's good enough. I mean, but you've got to do a genuine job, and the ICC hasn't decided yet whether it will take a case against a Brit. You talk about the torture that was authorized under certain Department of Justice memos that were issued during the Bush administration. Those that dealt with military custody were withdrawn in 2004. Those that dealt with what the intelligence community was doing rather secretively weren't withdrawn until the second day of Obama's administration. And we've read all about this, at least in the summary, the redacted summary of the 6,000-page U.S. Senate Intelligence Committee report. But there certainly are questions about the U.S. violating the Torture Convention and the context, whether these are crimes. The ICC has actually opened a preliminary examination on Afghanistan, because Afghanistan is part of the ICC. And if you commit a crime on the territory of a party, you're responsible. And so, and I had to deal with this quite often and try to provide information. I talk about this very much, but to show that we had done investigations. I don't think our investigations were sufficient, particularly of the intelligence community. Crimes that were documented by the Senate committee. But the ICC now has this. Of course, they have the other crimes in Afghanistan, the crimes of the Taliban. They're attacking on all sorts of civilian targets, etc. Rather clear, widespread war crimes and crimes against humanity. There are allegations of much more serious abuses in detention by the Afghanistan army, etc. So the U.S. is actually only a small part of this. But there's a chance the ICC could get into it now. Obviously, this would have a complicating and difficult situation when the ICC came to get cooperation with the U.S. During the Bush administration, first term, we were very hostile to the court, passed the so-called Invade the Hague bill, and authorized the president to invade the Hague, you know, if an American were caught. By the second Bush term, George W. Bush, we'd gone along with the Darfur referral. We had changed our policy on requiring countries to sign agreements not to surrender any American to the court. And then when we came in, we actually took up the position as active observers in the ICC. Under consistent with the Invade the Hague Act, the American Service Members Protection Act, we said we would cooperate in cases involving non-citizens if we thought they were in our interest. We can't pay any money, but we could contribute. We ended up, we got bill through Congress unanimously, both House and Senate, to extend our rewards program to the ICC fugitives. The last two ICC fugitives surrendered to the United States and to Uganda to our embassy in Kigali, Rwanda. Joseph Dominic Ungwen, who is Joseph Kony's number one deputy, surrendered to our counter-LRA unit in northern CAR, and we delivered them to the ICC. So we're cooperating with the court, case by case, in kind assistance, but not with U.S. citizens. But that issue is still out there. Understand the best answer to any of these things is that we prosecute our own, and important to note that U.S. military justice is better than almost anybody's, and we do prosecute Sergeant Bales when he kills 16 civilians in Kabul. He gets a life sentence. We use the civilian system when the Blackwater ex-military guys kill people in Azure Square, including his children on the back of a car in cold blood. They got great service records, but after a very tough trial, they got sentences of 30 years to life. So we do prosecute our own more than others do, but in a way we prosecute the ones that are really responsible and do our best. I think there's an argument that what Eric Holder did in appointing this attorney Durham to investigate, and Durham was a very tough guy who sent Whitey Bulger's friend, the FBI agent Connolly, to jail for 40 years. He's a tough prosecutor of official misconduct. He had eventually determined that there weren't prosecutable cases. So the ICC will have to weigh up whether we've met complementarity, even though we've not really charged anybody. But these laws apply to us, but of course primarily and always through our own system, and only through an international system when we don't do the job ourselves. Long answer, sorry. Other questions? Yes.
I think it was yesterday that Aung San Suu Kyi in Burma, Myanmar, was asked a question about whether the treatment of the Muslim minority amounted to ethnic cleansing. And she denied that it did. First of all, do you agree with that, with her point of view? And secondly, do you have any insight into what, you know, many of us see as kind of her puzzling position or silence with respect to the treatment of Muslims in Burma, Myanmar?
I mean, this, it's a challenge dealing with our world, because we're dealing with a variety of countries that are making decisions themselves on their own, in their own political processes, and we're trying to pressure them to. There's a tendency to view what's happened in Burma, certainly in the military freeing Aung San Suu Kyi and opening up the democratic process, albeit in a constitution that's rigged, with the military having a quarter of the seats, constitutional amendments taking three quarters, and with them continuing to control the national security ministries and preventing her from being formally president, though she's effectively the president. It's not perfect, but it has been progress. But I do think that what's happening in Burma in regard to the Rohingya is very serious. My friends at the Holocaust Museum recently published a report based upon extensive interviews on the Bangladesh side and Cox's Bazaar and that area. Where some of the people have escaped, but there has been horrible ethnic cleansing without question. These communities in Sitwa and elsewhere pushed out of places where they could fish and subsist and into areas where life is almost intolerable, sort of out of sight, out of mind. And the government should be doing something about that. And frankly, we have some have said Aung San Suu Kyi is doing as much as she can. She doesn't really control it. And of course, there is an attitude in Burma that we're generally Buddhist, and these people are foreigners, but they're foreigners that have been there, some for 150, their families for 150 years. And this kind of migration exists everywhere in the world, and these people can't be rendered stateless. They'll be recognized failure to call the Rohingya, the system calling them Bengalis, I mean, is an insult even there. So I don't think she's doing well enough on this, and we have to continue, I think, to pressure her to do it better. And the thing that scares me, to be frank about it, is the Rohingya have not been, I mean, they are Muslim, they're capable of being recruited by ISIS or Al-Qaeda, of sort of giving up hope and engagement. I don't mean to say that we should do things because people could do awful things otherwise, but that is often the result when you sort of cut off any sort of access to the system, the radicals get a foothold. We sure don't want that. Now, on the other hand, you then have people in that country saying, oh, well, these people are associated with terrorists. We don't want to let them close to us. But these things have to be, government has to obey international law. And at least the UN Special Rapporteurs on these issues continue, and Prince Zayed and others, and certainly the whole Muslim world, continues to raise this very tough issue, and it's not going away. But keep in mind, I mean, our approach always, certainly from an American point of view, and even from an international point of view, is if we've got to go in which it's possible to work at all, we work with them. And we try to get them to see the value of doing it right. The ability to take things to the international level is only for the most kind of extreme cases, and quite often not even possible then because of where our global system works. But it needs to be a continued priority. Now, where will we be with these issues in the Trump administration when President Sisi is hailed in Washington, even while many Americans are still in jail in Egypt? I think we'll perhaps give a lower priority, but I'm hopeful, given a lot of Republicans in Congress that support human rights, that eventually our position will return to the kind of commitment that we've traditionally had for human rights, and if for no other reason, for the reasons of stability and for the prevention of the kind of terrorism that sometimes results when you don't respect all the peoples in the community. Other questions? Tough one like that. Some other friend that's doing the wrong thing. Yes, go ahead.
Have you had success, or is it possible through these courts to recover stolen assets and return them to the country or the people when they were stolen?
That's a great question, and I mean, there are some hope of that. I mean, to the extent Habre has money left, the court in Senegal at the end of this month will make reparations order out of the money that's been seized from Habre and properties that he has on the beach in Dakar. In the ICC, the case of former Congolese Vice President Bemba, who was convicted for crimes in the Central African Republic, some of his assets have been seized and will be made available to victims. I will say, when I was dealing with Charles Taylor, even in the years before he was elected president in 97, when he controlled a country library, which he did for 6 years, he was famous for making these massive deals, arms for people getting immense amounts of hardwood and other natural resources. There were groups like Global Witness that said he'd stolen more than $100 million, et cetera. And we chased his accounts through several banking havens, et cetera. We were a small operation and didn't have a lot of cooperation, didn't really have a right, like a UN tribunal, Chapter 7 to mandate states to comply. And so we'd see money going out of an account, but then we'd send a request on to the other country and we'd never get an answer. So to some extent, this whole business of chasing stolen assets, the kind of things we see in the Panama Papers and elsewhere, and the kind of things that happen in banking havens, these people can hide and their money in nominated accounts, is an area, whether we're talking about terrorism or international human narco-trafficking or anything else, where I don't think the global system is yet fit for purpose. We've got too many holes in it, and that's, I think, kept us from getting the resources that are sometimes there. That's not to say, in many cases of war criminals, and we've We have one rich guy in from the Rwanda genocide that's basically been able to buy protection for many years and is still on the run at the age of 81. Most of the others have pretty well dissipated their assets by the time we seize them. And certainly if you're talking about the Dominic Unguins or Bosco and Ugandas or others, the warlords, that when we finally get them, they don't have much assets. But I really believe that there are possibilities out there, because quite often these war crimes relate very much to conflict minerals, relate very much to corruption, and there are assets that can be recovered. But it's an area that I think is underdeveloped. Yes.
I was wondering if you would talk a little bit about the human rights situation in Yemen or any potential issues there. I know there's been some reporting on the bombing of hospitals. I was wondering if you had any insight into whether there was a case being made against either side in that conflict.
Well, that has been a difficult one from a political standpoint, even the Human Rights Council, because of countries associated with Saudi Arabia and others that are fighting the Houthis that they believe to be an Iranian proxy, and really is an Iranian proxy. You have, so far, it has not been possible to get a commission of inquiry, even a fact-finding mission of the kind we had on North Korea or Iraq or Syria or Eritrea in that situation. The High Commissioner's Office for Human Rights, former Prince Zayed of Jordan, obviously a Sunni like the fighting there, has in his reporting to the Human Rights Council talked about these incidents, but it's been something that hasn't been explored enough, and certainly the allegations in terms of hitting hospitals, hitting and killing everybody at a funeral, a variety of things like that really raise serious questions. That said, I do want to be clear that as I deal with cases like Syria, even as we dealt with cases from the former Yugoslavia, that making cases based on bombing, people will be killed in counterinsurgency operations, even if you're very careful. And groups do hiding among civilian populations, and that's a crime, using human shields. It's a crime not to use cautions, but proving that someone intentionally tried to kill civilians is sometimes difficult. So these cases require certainly a much greater level of analysis than, say, the detention cases where you've got the prisons of a state and they murdered 50,000 people in custody. Then you clearly know who's responsible in bombing. It's much more difficult, but that's an area where not enough has been done. But there's continued pressure to do it. On the other hand, the conflict continues, and frankly, neither side has made much progress. And we hope there's peace. Though I understand at the moment, many of those that are engaged in the war economy see the advantage of keeping the conflict going, which is a real tragedy. But it's the kind of thing that I think takes real leadership to get in there to negotiate a peace and to end this conflict and develop some kind of relationship that will cause these crimes to stop, and then the question of who should be prosecuted. Yeah, Bob?
Can you say any more about the outlook for your position of ambassador at large and the office and your staff?
Well, that's a good question. The whole question of what happens in the State Department, as you may know, the President, I think, has talked about a 31% cut to state development, which is, there's nobody in Congress that thinks, and nobody certainly in the leadership of the budget process that thinks that's wise, and even someone like General Maddox, a.k.a. Mad Dog, and our Secretary of Defense testified a couple, 3 years ago that he wanted a bigger State Department. He wanted more engagement to prevent these conflicts before we ended up with the choice of going and shooting or hitting people with drones or whatever we wanted to do. That might make the situation worse. And so statecraft and all of that is not soft, which is apparently the sort of dichotomy on policy in this administration. But it's tough. We'll do it if it's soft. It's not. Of course, I argue criminal justice is tough too, and prosecuting war criminals is tough. And we certainly need. I didn't talk a lot about ISIS tonight. Should have. And I don't want to minimize at all the horrors of crimes you committed. We met just last week. Lincoln, Nebraska, by the way, is now home to 3,000 Yazidi. I don't know if you know that, but the group that has suffered a genocide at the hands of ISIS, in which at least 3,200 Yazidi girls and women are being held as sex slaves in eastern Syria and northern Iraq by ISIS. That those crimes need to be prosecuted. That could be if we work very hard with the Iraqis and the Kurdish regional government to develop a fair process for doing it. And, you know, on the other hand, the administration, my office had found $2 million to support investigations there. That was recently stopped by the administration. So those are the kind of things that concern me. Now, some of that is stopped because the budget may be cut dramatically and they don't want to let any money out the door. But nobody yet knows where these cuts are going to fall, what the State Department's going to look like, whether we'll even have a Human Rights Bureau that we've had since Gerald Ford was president. I mean, that could be, there's a Heritage Report, a Foundation Report that would fold human rights into political bureaus, the old Human Rights Office in every office, or in every bureau, but then who really fights for human rights when it comes to realpolitik versus human rights? Much more difficult to get to a satisfactory solution. So we don't really know. I tend to think when I had Caesar, this military photographer, in Washington on the 20th and 21st, we had a meeting with him and Senator Corker, chairman of the Senate Foreign Relations Committee from Tennessee, obviously a Republican, Congressman Royce of California, chairman of the House Foreign Affairs Committee. They're very supportive of these things. So, hopefully, that kind of view will prevail, that pushing legislation for us to document more and to prosecute. So I think that the office could be there in the future. We had a conference on Monday at Georgetown Law School on to celebrate the 20th anniversary of the office. And all of us ex-ambassadors were there. To celebrate it. We don't know if it'll be the 21st anniversary of that. But the office still continues. A person from our legal advisor's office had been appointed special coordinator. He heads it with the rank of ambassador. Almost all of the staff that I built is still there. Other people have rotated, and it's a small office with a dozen people. But and they're continuing to work on South Sudan, on Central African Republic, on ISIS crimes, on a variety of these issues. So, basically on autopilot, just basically giving out the same statements that we gave out months ago because no one has yet decided on what our new policies are. And of course, if they did decide, the way you do that is they don't come from on high, they come from an interagency discussion in which we participate. And really, the redevelopment of that interagency process hasn't occurred yet, even in the 80th day of this administration. So, we will see. I do think that a lot of these things have momentum inside and outside that would be impossible to counter. And I think that there'll be a day again when we'll be making progress on these issues. Yeah, did you want to follow up on that?
Just a quick follow up. Are any Iowa lawmakers, federal lawmakers in an important position on this?
Not really. The only, there are proposals that if we, there has been bipartisan support for strengthening our own laws in the United States, for instance, crimes against humanity, and that legislation would go to the Judiciary Committee, generally. Our friend Charles Grassley, and so that's. But beyond that, I think at this stage, none of our congressional people are directly involved. Yes, sir.
Yes. Well, I've heard from a few different sources that several African nations. prosecutions feel that they've been sort of unfairly prosecuted, or that most of the crimes that you've been prosecuting successfully have been African nations, and they're feeling that they've been sort of unfairly singled out, you know, among nations or areas, regions.
Well, and that's certainly out there and a challenge to the ICC, but I will say something about where I think there's some legitimacy in that argument, but fundamentally, the ICC has gotten involved in African countries because African countries have asked the ICC to be involved. There are like seven African situations and in sub-Saharan Africa, and each of them, with the exception of Kenya, were actually referrals by the state. Kenya and invited the prosecutor to come in, preferred an ICC case to establishing a domestic tribunal, which probably would have been a better choice. And the other cases in the ICC came from the Security Council. Now there's a new case in Georgia, Georgia, not Atlanta, but Tbilisi, involving the crimes of 2008, potentially dealing with crimes committed by Russia's allies in South Ossetia during that conflict. So the ICC does have a formal case, and of course it has these preliminary examinations in other places, Afghanistan, Iraq, Colombia, certainly outside the region. But of course in Colombia, we say, should the ICC jump into Colombia? Well, Colombia's developed a transitional justice plan. It's not perfect, but it's what the people want, and it will put both military and FARC people to trial. Then if they pay reparations and they tell the whole story, there may be alternative sentencing, and that doesn't bother me. I don't want the ICC to go in there and say, no, I'm not going to prosecute these people if they come up with a formula there. So in the African context, in each of the cases the ICC got involved in, there wasn't really anything at that time going on in that country at all on the prosecution. And so it was appropriate, I think, for the ICC to become involved. Fundamentally, though, this is about the fact that when the ICC has gone after armed groups, Joseph Kony, or Warlords of the Congo, or Al-Faqi al-Mahdi, the fellow from Ansuddin, who helped destroy the tombs, ancient tombs in Timbuktu, countries like that, but when they go after people that are in power in those countries, they obviously don't. And in every one of those situations on my trips, the victims and survivors say, you know, the ICC was exactly justified. We just wish they were tougher, not that they were easier. Now, will countries withdraw? Last year, we had three countries notify withdrawal from the ICC of the 34 African countries that are in. Two of those have now withdrawn their withdrawals. Gambia, after the successful, after the pressure, thanks to West African countries doing the right thing, pressuring President Jammeh to leave office, and the new president is put back in the ICC. South Africa withdrew, but their courts recently ruled in a case begun by a public interest law firm that violated the Constitution, and they can only withdraw from treaties after a public discussion, public hearings, legislative action. They can still do it if President Zuma, who is challenged in other ways, pushes it to the parliament, but it's not sure that they will do that. Burundi, on the other hand, where the president's overstayed his welcome, got another term, where there's violence that threatens, in terms of the numbers of deaths, it's not in the multiple thousands yet, but it's risky, and so the prosecutor has been looking at going in. They gave notice last September, and so the prosecutor has until September investigation on Burundi. Probably will, because if she does, then she continues to be able to deal with those crimes, even if Burundi withdraws. But the reason they quit is because their president was facing the heat because of crimes for which he may be responsible. So they're not getting these withdrawals because of what. Because the ICC is being unfair. They're doing it because they're crimes that aren't being punished. But in terms of the African attitude, there is underlying of all the sort of sense that the world is kind of rigged by the Security Council, that a Syrian can't come to the ICC and their cases do, and that that they're more likely to be the subject of the prosecution because it's easier for countries in the global north to come together and decide to do something when it's not elsewhere. And I think that's an unfair aspect of our global system that's difficult to deal with, but it is a legitimate criticism, just as you heard from me. I mean, how can you inform the 50,000 dead in Syria, the worst crime of the century, and not have an international tribunal doing it? But it's a reflection of our 1945 global governance structure and the Security Council. Yes?
On Joseph Comey, what's happened for him in Africa, that the children, soldiers are like, how come he's not?
Good question. The ICC was the first case they did. They charged Comey and about five of his lieutenants. He has since killed three of those guys. and we have, we think Odhiambo's dead too in a firefight, and Ungwen surrendered to us. So Comey is still out there. On the other hand, because of the ICC case, he's out of Uganda and he's been committing his predations in Central African Republic and DRC, South Sudan, and Southern Darfur, and Sudan. Increasingly, because of the operation, which we're providing intelligence support to the Ugandan military and other military, his operations are much quieter. He's not killing, raping, kidnapping as many as he used to. The operations are still ongoing. We don't actually run them. We provide advice to the Ugandans. I was hopeful that we would have him relatively shortly after we got Ungwen in January 2015. We knew where he was roughly at that time, but there wasn't a fast enough reaction. And as one Ugandan general said, oh, this area is so difficult, he says, the trees are thicker than broccoli, you know, when you look down, it's very hard to, it's not an area where high tech works, and you're not talking about someone who's using communications or social media or anything else. And so you've got that challenge. But the effort to bring him in continues, but it's extremely frustrating. When you go after a non-state group, and everybody in the world would love to have Comey on trial, there's no friends that he has, but it's still a matter of being able to mount operations in areas that are essentially beyond the reach of any state.
Well, okay. Please join me in, again, welcoming and thanking Ambassador.
So again, thank you, Ambassador, and thank you as well for hanging around for a few days and participating in our Constitutional Law Conference on Saturday. We look forward to that. Reminder, this is the first event of the 4th Annual Nelson Conference, so there's more to come. I think, David, there was a handout that went around.
Yes.
So if you've got that, please pay attention, and many more events. We'd love to see you at all of those. Thank you for being here this evening. David, anything else?
Nope, you did.
All right, thank you, everyone.